And here we are. Well, folks, we're back on the Crown Star today. I've not done much to it in the last 2 or 3 weeks, although I have been doing jobs off the bike. The video about the centre pull brakes, that was the brakes for this bike. And you saw me spending a few minutes polishing a nice SR alloy stem, that was also from this bike. So I finished that last video by saying let's get it back on the bike. So today we're going to be reassembling the parts. I've got the parts down here, most of them anyway, and there's a little bucket of bits and pieces I took off. These are most of the parts that I know are for this bike. And we have the wheels here. Wheels are worthy of mention. I've given them a nice polish, as you can see. Now, I polished these with the same polishing wheel as I did the stem with, because I'll just show you something. When you get these polishing kits for your angle grinder, for your bench grinder, sorry, you get one of these, which is an arbor, and the wheel simply screws onto here. This one on here is a left-hand thread, because the grinder turns this way, so when you apply pressure to the wheel, it's pulling itself further onto the threads. Now, that's the wrong way for a drill, but you can get a right-hand threaded arbor for the drill. And so I've got one of the wheels on the drill. You can see it's looking a bit like it's been dragged through a hedge backwards. That is because I've been doing the wheels with it. Just by hand, like this, the wheel laid down, sorry for the knocking there, just the wheel laid down and going over it. Even got the spokes a bit as well. So the wheels have had a nice little clean up. The rims too, the rims were done by hand. And the tyres are a classic pair of Continental Conti Top Touring. I remember back in the 90s, certainly, these were the almost the default tyre for cycle touring. For your traditional touring bikes, many Adore Super Galaxy would have had a pair of these on. I had this pair hanging up for quite some time and I've been waiting to use them. So they're going on the Crown Star. As you can see, I haven't put the valve retaining ring on there yet. Little collar, that'll go on just in case I have to let the tyres down for any reason as I'm fitting them. The freewheel, it's a screw on freewheel, and it's a 6-speed. The bike actually had a 5-speed on. I was going to put a wide ratio old perfect, I think it was 32 outer. I had this 6-speed Sachs laid around. Looking for a home. It's a bit second hand, but it'll clean up with use. The unusual feature is the built-in spoke guard. If you can see, that's actually welded into the larger ring. I've never seen one of those before, not knowingly. So, being an interesting unusual part, I thought I'd put that on. So there's the wheels, there's the mud guards. We have mud guard stays, the brakes, the brake bits and pieces, stem, handlebars, which already came with red handlebar ends. The seat post I'd like to upgrade, I think. I don't like the old fashioned clamps. Handlebar tape I have, some nice red cloth tape, traditional. And a saddle I have. In fact, you can see it hanging up over there with the red ticket, on top of that red ticket there. That's the saddle that's going on. But they're just finishing off pieces. They're not important at this stage. We've got to get it back together mechanically first. Another two items that are missing are pedals. It had some oldie style, here they are, some oldie style, okay but not brilliant, pedals on it. I'm going to put something a bit better, some nice alloy quill pedals or something. Something with clips and straps, as befits the bike and its era and purpose, etc. Appropriate to the bike. And one other item that's missing is brake levers. The brake levers that were on here were not suitable for this purpose, but I do have some that I'm going to cull. Here on the Motobacan are some Weinmann red spot levers, so called because of the red. That's actually the pivot of the lever inside, anodized red on these levers. These are the ones I want for that bike. They haven't got those horrible 1970s lever extensions that we used to call suicide levers, but these will do nicely for the Crown Star. As you can see, they're on the Skagfjord handlebars of the Motobacan. The Motobacan is next in line to be refurbished. I'm doing a phase one and a phase two. Eventually it'll be all upgraded throughout. Phase one is put it into use, and part of that is I'll be replacing the handlebars, and I'll be replacing these with something nice, which is to be disclosed. So I'm going to see whether I need to hack all this tape off up to here in order to slide the lever down, or whether we can get away with it and take it straight off. That depends on the type of clamp, and I'm going to do that now. Now, getting these levers off can be either very simple or a right royal pain in the backside, depending on the type of clamp that the lever is held onto the bars with, and I don't know that until I go in there. Inside here you will have either a flat blade screwdriver slot, as in this case, or there'll be an Allen head, a hex head for an Allen key. So I'll just get the screwdriver, slacken this off. When you've got the cable in, it can be a pain because the cable comes down in front of the screw that you need to undo. So it's best to take the cable out if you can, or at least take it off at the brake end and release the tension so you can get the screwdriver past it, or the Allen key. Right, screwdriver. These will be quite tight. I've just done it two-handedly off camera, and they should be tight, otherwise your lever's loose. This is what you need if you find a pair of these levers that are moving around. That's where you need to tighten them. What I need to do now, though, for the purposes of investigation, is to take this screw right out, which you don't normally need to do. If you've got bare handlebars, you can now take that lever off. Aha, we're in luck. Now, there are two types of clamps here. There we are, sorry. There are two types of clamps that you can use here, that you can find you've got here. This type are the type we want because they're just held in by their own tension. What happens is the body of the lever, here, as it tightens up onto there, squeezes this clamp and then holds everything tight, and that's what clamps it to the handlebars. Now, the other type of clamp is brazed or soldered or crimped together, and it's permanently together and you can't do anything about it. This type, great, because they're just held together by the tension of the spring steel that the clamp is made from. So all you do now is what I'm doing: take the center part off, and then you can just, I need to cut a little bit of tape behind it, and then I'll be able to get this clamp off without detaping the handlebars, because these handlebars are junk anyway. That's great news. If you're storing the levers, it's best to put them back together. And you can see here how, when I tighten the screw that you saw me undoing, it pulls the clamp onto or into the inside of the lever housing, which pushes on the inside of the clamp and tightens it onto the handlebars. That's how it grips. Right, I think these need a clean up. Now the other side, the front one, is still attached, it's still working. So I'm going to have to disconnect this cable. First thing I'm going to do is put the adjuster right down, back off the locking ring, screw the adjuster right down to give as much slack as possible. So much slack we've got there. Yeah, that should be enough to get that cable off now, but again I'll need an extra hand. There we are, that's released the tension on the cable. So now I can move it to one side. It's nice and slack, so I can get the screwdriver in now. Now inside the lever, you can see where the cable goes into the little cable stop, stroke, fulcrum, whatever you want to call it. And there it is inside. You can see the head of the nipple in the larger hole. You can see it's slotted. So what we need to do is push the cable and it'll pop out of that slot and come out. However, as is often the case, it's stuck. So I'm going to have to get in with little rat nose pliers and have a little bit of a fiddle about to get that cable out of there rather than waste the thing. There we are, popped out, and now it'll just come out of that slot and away. And that's the lever freed. Put the motorbike can back in the corner where it was, and that is awaiting it's a little bit of refurbishment. Got a few nice little French bits to go on here, so it's going to be more of a multi-purpose French bike, but that's next. I think that'll do, don't you? I'm not supposed to be going for mirror finish with this bike. It's supposed to be working bike. So I think we've got everything together now. Time to wash these filthy hands and start some assembly. Slight seat post disappointment. This is the original, it's 26.4, and I have almost no 26.4s in my stack of seat posts. So it looks like I'm stuck with what I've got. I'll give it a bit of a polish. Now, as I said, I was polishing this. I'm sure at least one or two of the knowledgeable bike geeks would have said, no! Don't panic. I've only polished it down to where the maximum mark is, which is about where I'll be having it anyway. I've left the bottom half dull, and in fact I've gone over it with coarse wire wool, just to give it a bit of extra key. If you've got a very shiny seat post inside your stem, inside your seat tube, it's not going to grip very well. You want it to grip and not be twirling round, not have the saddle moving about. So you leave a bit of a key. See where this has been badly scored, which has been taken in and out. That's why I wanted to change it. But never mind, I've got to live with this now. That's not fatal. I polished a lot of it out on the top surface there. You can still see a bit. But yeah, the bottom surface, where it's going to go into the tube, I've deliberately left with a key on it, so it'll grip. Now I have put the seat post back in here temporarily, because it is essential to one of the earliest parts of the bike assembly. I need to put the seat pin binder bolt in there because I need to have my brake cable hanger before I can fit the brakes, which is one of the earlier jobs that I want to do, because that helps me mount the mudguards. That has to be done before the wheels go in, etc, etc. Check I'm putting this in the right way up. I wasn't. There we are, I'm happy with that now. Bend it to its right width, right. Right, so I'll nip that up finger tight and I can now hang my brake cable on there and set the brakes up. So let's get hold of one of the brakes. They're both the same. And I need to fit the mounting bolt for the rear, which is the short of the two mounting bolts. And now I need to grab my rear mudguard. This is where the bike begins to take shape. Clip the mudguard. It's got a little spring clip. Now, pop that in there just for the moment and find and fetch the correct shaped washer that goes around the tube. There it is. Fiddle, fiddle, faff. Show you this. That's what I'm talking about with the correct shaped washer. I don't even know if you could see that because I'm working on the opposite side to the screen, so I can't even monitor what's in frame or not. Everything's pulling against itself. Right, that's roughly mounted up. Pop the nut on slackly, and the next thing will be to get some stays in there, put them on loosely, and then I can get a wheel in. Right, we have a mudguard in place and a brake in place loosely. Mudguard is simply one of these eye bolts. Let me pick one out for you. That slides down the mudguard stay and goes through the bracket and bolts on the front. It's best when you're assembling these to just nip them up without bending the mudguard. Let the mudguard find its natural shape. As much as possible when you're setting up mudguards, let them find their natural shape. If you need to do an adjustment on the road, say you needed to adjust that a little bit, it's best to slacken off all four and then let the mudguard stay out of tension, if you like. Let it stay slack. If you've got tension in the mudguard, that's what induces premature splits and cracks. And that's why a lot of people don't like these plastic mudguards, is because of the splits and cracks that they're prone to. Most of that is due to incorrect fitment. People fit it by having it under tension all the time, or under twisting, or under forces all the time. And it's not good, obviously. But of course, these things are usually sold as accessories outside of mainland Europe. So they're left to the amateur home person to fit themselves. So if they're left to be DIY fitted, then there are going to be problems. And a lot of mechanics aren't trained properly, or they hate them or whatever, so they don't put the care into them that they should. Buy a properly integrated bicycle in the first place and they will have been properly fitted. Now, we've got this roughly in place. It's held in at the front by a clip, a spring clip around the chainstay bridge, and then, as I showed you before, it's held in on the brake mounting bolt there. So I'm leaving that for the moment because it's time to offer up the wheel. Oh, one little tip, use a shorter bolt in this side, because this has got to stay as flush with the dropout as possible. Don't have it protruding if you can help it. Come on, focus. Don't have it protruding if you can help it, because it's got to clear the freewheel. This side can come in a little bit more, that doesn't matter so much, but I will trim that off when I've put a nut on it. Although these are threaded eyelets, do put a nut on the inside if there's room. It's just a little bit of belt and braces security. But now it's time to offer up a wheel. Right. Pop the quick release skewer through. I like putting in wheels when the bike's upside down. I'm offering up at the moment, we're not fitting the wheel, and I'll explain to you in a minute why we're not fitting the wheel at this stage. This is just seeing how things go together. I need to make sure that the wheel will go past. You see, I've got no spacers in yet. I'm seeing what I need in terms of spacing. That wheel is going to slot straight in, but the free wheel needs spacing out. So I will need to fit my spacer pieces just about to the end. There is a set distance by which this should protrude, by which the axle should protrude. You can see it already set up on this side. So basically it's the width of the frame material, so that when you tighten the quick release down, it has something to bear on. It can bear on the frame material. So I need to space out this side now that I'm happy that it's going to fit in there properly. Here we are, I've got that spaced out properly now. The amount of thread you have protruding here does depend from bike to bike. It varies from bike to bike depending on your dropout material. This is a thin plate dropout, so it doesn't need very much. If this was an alloy frame, that would be very thick. If it was something like an investment cast bottom bracket, a Campagnolo or something like that, it would be a bit thicker as well. But I'm happy with that now. It's very important to get the rear wheel spacing correct. And you need to have the wheel sitting in the middle of the frame, and you need to have the correct clearances for your free wheel as well. Most of all though is that you need to be able to slot the wheel in and out comfortably without having to bend the frame, without having to put any tension on the frame. And when you're taking, when you've got a stack of wheels hanging from your ceiling, and you're using second-hand wheels in bikes that you're building up, there we are. That's going to need adjustment, need setting up rather. Obviously, you've got to adapt each wheel to each bike carefully. Whereas these are the wheels that came out of this bike, so I'd expect them to be something like already. There we are. I do like fitting wheels with the bike upside down, it's so much easier. So I'm just going to pop that quick release on there now. I'm not sure that this quick release was originally intended for this bike, because it's a little bit long, about 5 millimeters longer. I'm going to put the wheel in the middle of the slot, not all the way forward or all the way back. And I'm going to look at things with the wheel in the middle of its adjustment. Nip up the quick release. All right, I've got the bike, I've got the wheel in the center there. It is in the center between the chainstays, so that shows that the frame's probably straight. I just need to faff about with the mudguard adjustments now. I think I'll lift the mudguard slightly on this bridge as well. It looks to be a little bit tight underneath there. And I'm definitely happy with that so far. So there we have it. This is where we are now. I've adjusted these to give a uniform gap as much as possible. The gap does reduce slightly down here. It's not purely a matter of clearance under the bridge. that causes this gap to reduce. The mudguard seems to have become a little bit flattened on the top, and my guess is that someone has run a saddlebag weighted on the top of there for many years, and it's deformed the mudguard slightly. So that's all in. Same at the front now. I'm just going to hang the brake, hang the mudguard, pop the wheel in, same as before. No need for you to have to sit through it all. I will just show you that the front brake has a longer mounting bolt, and if you remember my video on centre pull brakes, you squeeze the brake like that to drop the bolt in, and you see the washer on the front brake is a shallow curve which matches the curve of the crown of the fork, so it sits in there nicely. The shaped washer here is not just a decorative thing either. It helps to clamp the brake securely and flatly against a flat surface, which avoids vibration, which is squeaking. Now, another point at the back, here's the mudguard mounted at the back. If I need some more tyre clearance and I've got to push the mudguard up, it can foul the headset. And I've seen these mounted where the top of the bracket is up and rubbing against the bottom crown race and induces friction. Something to watch out for. Don't let this bracket foul your headset. You can bend the top of the bracket back if necessary. Of course, we do take care to mount the brake perfectly centrally as well. That's going to be essential when it comes to setting things up. Now, here's something of interest. For the front mudguard mountings, I've decided to depart slightly from original period specification and use some of these. I don't like plastic on the bikes, but in this case I'm going to use the SKS detachable breakaway safety mountings for the front mudguard stays. The reason I've gone for these is because they are such a worthwhile and phenomenal safety feature for just that little block of plastic. So what happens is your standard mudguard stays go into here and are gripped tightly enough to hold the mudguard, but if a stone or something, stick, catches behind the mudguard, instead of everything locking up, pulling around, the mudguard folds up, your forks bend back, you're over the handlebars, possibly dead, what happens is that these just pull out, they just break away, and so you're able, at least you get a fighting chance to be able to stop safely and save your skin. I like them on bikes with plastic front mudguards, and so they're going on here. And there we have front mudguard on, front wheel in. I need to trim the ends of the stays on all the mudguards as part of the final setup of the bike. So now we need to get some handlebars in so we can mount brake levers. We've already got a gear lever mounted, and then we can start setting up the gears and the brakes, putting some cables on, and then the final finish of pedals, saddle, handlebar tape, etc. Not far now. Well, we hit a snag to do with handlebar widths. These are my preferred handlebars because of the shape, lovely period design, and they're what I'd like on this bike. However, getting some the nice SR stem wrestled onto them was not a pleasant experience. Things got sweary, words were said. So when you upload a video onto YouTube, there's a little checkbox, is this made for kids? No, it definitely would not have been made for kids if I'd been recording this. So now I've got to have a little rootle, find a suitable stem for these handlebars that doesn't look out of place on the bike and gives a reasonable reach and a little bit of forward. sorry, reasonable height and a little bit of forward. I've got my eyes on that lovely old Milremo on the Motobacan, but I mustn't because I want it on there. Okay, let's see where we're going with this. So, I settled on this Sakai, which is maybe a little modern for the bike, but with a polish, it looks fine. It was a grey anodized finish. I just gave it a quick polish, and so there's some marks on it there. They're just polish marks. Right, find the binder bolt and the expander bolt, and that'll be fine. Notice I've left it not shiny at the bottom for the same reason I left the seat post like that. I will just take off that bit of muck though. And there we are, one more stage towards completion. Let's get some brake levers on, and then it's time for some adjustments, some cables, and a chain. Okay, so it's the next night, and we've got the Crown Star ready to turn into a bicycle from the brakeless hobby horse that it is at the moment. It needs a chain and gears and brakes. So the first thing to do, the datum point from which all else is set, is the rear mech and what are known as the limit screws. Again, forgive me if you know all this already. These videos are partly here to help newcomers, people new to the hobby, so please bear with me if I'm preaching to the converted here. Now, as I say, when you're setting up, whether it's front and rear gears or just rears or whatever, any derailleur setup, the first setting you need to look at is the limit screws, which limit how far in and out the gear mech actually goes. And the first one we need to go to is the outside. Because the mech is sprung to the outside, when you're changing gear, more cable comes out, the cable basically gets relaxed at the end of here, and everything else is pulling the cable. And these are the two screws on this mech. It's very easy on this mech. Other mechs will have them in different places. Usually, hopefully, they will be labelled high and low. High is outside, higher gear, low is inside. These screws effectively move the cage of the mech in and out when it's at rest. And what we want is for the rear mech, when it's at rest, so it's in high, to be perfectly in line with the outer sprocket. And you can see on this one, it's almost a whole gear misaligned. It's too far in. It needs to come out so that the jockey wheel of the mech here lines up with the outer sprocket. Now that I've got some light on the subject, you can probably see better. So, if I go to the limit screw marked high, which is usually lower down on the mech, as I turn it, you will see the mech gradually moving out. Keep turning until it's lined up. If we look at it from the back, that's lined up pretty much spot on with the outer sprocket. So when you change into top gear, that will go onto that sprocket and no further. That's why it's called a limit screw. If it goes further, then your chain goes down into here and potentially could even wreck your frame and wreck your whole bike, so be careful. Right, so that's where the whole system is hung from, and we've set that now. Same deal with the inside. What have we got inside? We've got it going about a gear short again, so we've got an issue here as well. Whereas if I go too far in, parts of the mech are going to contact the chain guard, so I'm going to have to watch how that goes, or we might have an issue and might have to change the freewheel. Now that I've been able to get a hand on it properly onto the correct angle, it's actually, when I pull it in, it's actually going in too far. It's actually going way past the inner sprocket, which would mean it would just hit that chain guard. So we need to screw the low limit screw in, and as we do that, the mech would effectively move out if I was holding it like this, but I've only got two hands. I don't know how well you can see that, but the mech is now perfectly lined up with the inner sprocket and it is not touching the chain guard, so we're okay there. So that's the inner and outer setup. There is another setting called the B screw on many mechs, but not this one. And that, sorry about the camera work there, the B screw would be down here or down under here. And when you turn it, that's better. When you turn the B screw, it moves the mech back and forth and limits how far forward it'll come, which helps to govern the behaviour of the mech around the chain when it's entering the freewheel. I can't show you that without one to demonstrate on, so never mind that for the moment. We're doing this bike tonight. Let's get a chain on it. Okay, I popped a chain on. This isn't a brand new chain straight out of the box, but it is a chain which I took off here when I first got the bike and put it in a box because the chain was just about new. So it soaked in oil for a few months and then it's been cleaned off and dried off and it's absolutely fine. This is now parked in bottom gear. What I've done is spin the pedals round and manually push the gear mech in and out to check that it slips into bottom and slips into top and doesn't slip over the ends. I might pop it on the tripod and show you properly when I've got the cable on, so I can show you how it shifts. Chain length. If I was being picky, I'd take another link out of here, because this cage here should be sort of vertically downwards when it's in about middle gear. To be honest, this isn't a wide ratio gear set because it's only got the single chain wheel, so it'll be fine. There's enough there. Now I'm going to imagine now that we've slammed it into top gear while it's in bottom, which you shouldn't do, and there it goes, straight down into bottom, into top, sorry. And you can see there's still enough clearance on there. If that was any longer, see, the chain would start impacting here, the mech would start impacting on the freewheel. There's plenty of clearance there, nothing to worry about. The chain length is acceptable. As I say, if it was a triple on the front or an ultra wide on the back, a mullet setup or something like that, I'd be more picky. But this is a very tolerant old six-speed bike. They do have much more tolerance for this sort of thing than modern bikes do. It's not going to be indexed or anything like that, so we're fine. Chain on, now gear cable. Gear cable on this is very simple. I've just threaded it through. Make sure it's the pear nipple shape. Give it a good tug, that needs to sit down more in there. And now I need to double it round, wind it through the bottom of the lever. And there's an adjuster goes in here, but the adjuster was just too small to get the cable through like this. So I've taken it out, I'll now feed the adjuster onto the cable and put it in there that way. And pull the cable in properly. I've just put the adjuster in there halfway. Now, because we're running an open cable, that adjuster's not going to do anything in this application. If we were running a cable housing, then that would adjust the gears. I find it interesting that such a vague method of changing as this friction down tube shifter has a fine adjuster on it at all. Was it ever intended to go into anything that's going to be indexed? Now, our first cable guide is down here, which is a stop. I need a length of outer cable to go to, can I show it to you there? There's the other end, so we need a short length to run it through the bottom bracket area. And then, of course, I need the traditional up and over length at the back. See if I've got some red, but I don't think I have. Well, look what Daddy found. Hoo-hoo! Right, I put the cable through here. Couldn't find an extra bit of red to go through that bit, so I've used some innocuous silver grey that you won't see behind the chain wheel really. That there, that was a fiddle. Getting the wire through that little hole. Yeah, that was a fiddle. Right, put that bit of back housing on, and then we've got the cable around into the mech. It goes into here. I need to turn around that way, which is a barrel adjuster, and because there's housing going into it, it will actually work as an adjuster. Then nip the cable up and see where we are. And there we are. Zip tie alert. But to be honest, the cable was trying to spring up in an even curve, as it would do, which tried to stress this end here. It would have led to fraying. So, you know, function comes first. Give it a nice straight exit from there by just tying it down here with a nice red cable tie. And I need to find a clamp bolt for here. Clamp nut, sorry, and special washer. I'm sure I'll have one. There we are. Running away nicely. Pop it down a little. This is pure guesswork. Guessing on the lever really, the increments, and there we are. Obviously holding a camera is not always the easiest way to do these checks, but rest assured I've already done them and everything seems fine. I mean, it's the simplest of transmissions, a 6-speed non-index down tube shifter, old-fashioned derailleur. If I can't get this perfect, I shouldn't be working on bikes. It can be difficult without pedals. Some of you, like myself, maybe noticing the fact that I haven't got ferrules on the ends of all the cables. That's because this particular type of cable stop on this frame acts as a ferrule. The cable tucks nicely inside. It is its own ferrule, as is the rear adjuster. If you try putting a ferrule on, it'll stand outside of that stop and it won't work. It'll be completely ineffectual. That's why there are no ferrules. Right, it's now time to get a breaker cable in. This is called a pear nipple shape, this, which is what you need for these drop bar levers, into the hole in the top of the lever. Remember where it came out of when I took the levers off? And let's pop it in the slot and in. There we are, that's now attached inside there. What I need to do is, with my third hand, keep a little bit of tension on there while I pop a ferrule and the cable outer on there, because I don't want to let it all drop out from inside or misplace itself. It's a full length cable, it's got a bit of weight to it dangling down there. I think that's going to hold it in while I go and put the outer on. This is the ferrule that we need, this variety, and it will sit in the hole on top of there with the cable into here. You'll see when I get it assembled. I just go to the end of the cable now and slide this over and in. Like that. You can get these plastic in different colours, but I thought an aluminium one in this application would be best. Now I'll do the same with the outer, giving it a lube before I put it on. So there's the cable through the hanger at the back. And what I've done is take care when I route it to just use some temporary tape to hold it where it's going to go approximately, so that I get it in a nice bend around to the lever here. So when it's got some tension on, that will stand up in there. I don't want too big a loop here. It has to go down in front of the handlebars and then down. Usually goes to the opposite side of the stem to what the brake lever is. That is purely to give this bend more room to make it a shallower bend, and then it will run along the top of the top tube in three clamps, and then taking a nice even arc into the rear hanger and down to the brake. So now I'm happy with that, I can get the clamps on. The clamps themselves are these lovely things. They usually come in threes, and they predate brazing on the cable guides on the top tube. Used to have three of these instead. Rather fetching little bits of jewellery. There's the middle one fitted first. And nature has given us quite a handy guide, because the paint has faded around where they were. So there's a perfect outline of this clamp, which I've just put it over. There we are. Making sure, of course, that they're evenly spaced, though they look awful. Yes, I am glad I used red. I don't care what anybody thinks. Right, I've popped the pads in there. Just put them on finger tight. And when I squeeze the caliper, they line up nicely with the rims. And now the particular MAFAC straddle cable with its little ball nipples on it, into one side, into the other side, and now I need the straddle under here. But first we need this squeezing together, and there are various tools called third hand tools available for this. Otherwise you can use a toe strap or something similar, just to keep this caliper squeezed onto the rim while we attach the stirrup onto the straddle wire and then onto the main cable. Right, this is how this goes, the stirrup. I've used a new eye bolt. This is an eye bolt with the cable going through. I've used a new one because I had them in stock. They're slightly different, so I've had to use a little washer to space it out. But then the main cable goes down through the little cutout in the stirrup, and that's the straddle wire running through behind it. So the main cable holds the straddle wire in, stops it popping out. And that's how it all sits together on the bike. There we are. That's the brakes on. All we need now is some pedals, a saddle, and some handlebar tape. That is a job for after I've washed my hands. Here's the saddle I'm going to use. It's an old Dors La France that came out of a rescued wreck of a bike. And what's this, you say? This is a shoelace. You can see how with age the sides are beginning to flare out, and the purpose of these holes is to lace them together to pull the saddle together. That's what I'm going to do now. That does look a bit like a cat's cradle from underneath, but I don't know if that's the official approved way of doing it, but you know, we're playing here, aren't we? So the important thing is it's pulled the saddle together, and it will stop it from splaying out and then sagging in the middle. So let's get this on now. And here we are. This is just a first shakedown test ride, and I suppose I'd better address the elephant on the handlebars. I only had a little bit of red cable outer. Even that needs a bit of a clean. But I shall acquire a bit more and match the cables up, because I can't live with that. otherwise, the traditional cloth handlebar tape. Otherwise, we have traditional cloth handlebar tape I decided not to film putting the handlebar tape on because there are loads of people all over YouTube who do some wonderful jobs of handlebar tape, and I'm just not expert at it. Barely competent is how I'd describe myself. There's some polish on the rims there. See, that's a different kind of squeak to when you get that juddering squeak. That's a polish on the rims squeak. I'm not taking you on a test ride now. I'm leaving that for tomorrow. The light's going now, so I'm going to leave the test ride for tomorrow. But I'm just going to give you a look. I popped the original pedals back on just for speed because of the light going. But there we have the glam shot. Still to be done is trimming the ends of the mudguard stays. I'll do that in the morning and put an old saddlebag on, put some better pedals on and take it for a proper test ride. So I've been around the block, of course, but I'm not going to tell you how it rides because I don't want to spoil tomorrow's video. So if you've stayed this long, thank you for watching. Look out for the test ride video, hopefully tomorrow, if not the day after. Depends what I get around to doing. And I've just had my vaccination today, so who knows, I might feel rough tomorrow. But there we are, a lovely indeterminate age, mid-century English touring bike. And I can't say any more than that until I bring you the test ride. So please share around, please subscribe if you're not subscribed, and I'll see you very soon. Bye bye now.